wine, that the reason why if you change places with the wine, you still would have to say Atav HaMeitiv because it was a group there with them. Now we said if you built a new house, there's a question, is the Mishnah said that you have to say, again, you have to say Shechianu here. And there's an argument between at the bottom of the page, Rav Huna says that the only time you make a bracha is that if you do not have that type of a vessel in your house, a couch. If you do not have a couch and you bought a couch, that's when you say Shechianu. But if you already had a couch in your house, such as if you received it by Yerusha, inheritance from someone, then you wouldn't have to. Rav Yochanan says, on the contrary, there's the last line of the page, Afilu yesh lo keyotzeba, and that even if you had a couch in your house that you received in another way, tzeich levarach. So the Gemara, the top of Daf Samach Amud Aleph. Huh? Well, that's what we're saying. We're talking about here about vessels, not about making the house. The actual vessels that you think that you'll buy in the house. So it says Michlal. So the Gemara deducts from this the Chikana, the Chazar Vikana, that from here we see that the only time that you wouldn't have to make a bracha, it's only if you had it such as in a way that you received it. However, the Gemara says, the chikana, the chazar v'kana, but if you bought such a vessel or a cow, you bought something, the chazar v'kana, divra kol ein tzech levarach. From here we could deduct that if you personally went ahead and bought a couch, and then you went out a year later and you bought another couch, now when you buy the second couch, you do not need that. We would assume that Rav Huna and Rav Yochanan both agree that you do not have to make a bracha. V'ika the amre, and there's a different opinion that says, Amar Rav Huna, lo shanu. He says, when does the Mishnah say that you have to make a bracha? Ela shalokana b'chazar v'kana. He goes to the extreme case. He's the Ika the amre says that if he did not buy and then buy again, that's when you make a bracha shechianu. That's only in the sense that had you personally bought one before, and that's why when you're buying now a second time, you don't make. However, aval kana, the chazar v'kana and tzech levarach. So the only time that you would not have to make a bracha is actually if you bought one and then you bought it again. But if you had received it through a inheritance, then you would have to make a bracha. Rav Yochanan amar, afilu kana, the chazar v'kana, tzech levarach. And Rav Yochanan would go an extreme, and he would say that even if you personally bought the couch before, and now you're coming a year later and buying another one, so now Rav Yochanan becomes more down the line. So it's not only if you had one in the house and you bought one that you would have to make a bracha, but in fact, even if you bought one, you personally bought it, you would have to make a bracha. Michlal, the chli yesh lo v'kana. So here now he deducts the opposite, that if he had one in the house, and now you bought it, Divrei Hakol, meaning Rav Huna and Rav Yochanan would agree, Shetzech Levarach, because he was saying that the only time that Rav Huna would say that you don't is if you didn't have it at all. Meisvei, here comes something a little bit complicated. But in a Bais Chadash, we have a mission that says, if a person went ahead and built a new house, Ve'en lo kayotze bo, he does not have, never had a house like this before, Okana, or kana kelim chadashim, or if he went ahead and bought new vessels for his house, a couch. He did not have anything as the like in his house beforehand. Tzrich levarach, he does have to make the brach. Now here comes the question, where we're going to be. We're going to find a stira, some type of a disagreement. Yesh lo kayotzebem. Well, what happened in the situation if he already had a couch in his house? And now he's buying a new one. Ein tzerech levarach, divrei Rabbi Meir. Rabbi Meir says that if you already had in your house something of that nature, so you received it by inheritance, and now you're buying a new one, so Rabbi Meir says you do not need to make a bracha. Rabbi Yehuda Oimer, Rabbi Yehuda says, no, benkach, ubenkach tzerech levarach. He says, whether you had something in inheritance in your house or whether you didn't, if you buy a new one, you have to make a new bracha. So bish lemalalishna kama. So as we see, right at the top of the page where it says michlal dekana, the chikana, that first line over there, that's the lishna kama. So there we see the lishna kama says that what's happening between Rav Huna and Rav Yochanan. So he's saying, according to this, a first opinion of the way they learned the Mishnah, the lishna kama, Rav Huna k'Rav Meir, Rav Yochanan k'Rav Yehuda. because we're seeing that Rav Huna says that you only make a bracha if you do not have something in your house. And that's when you would make a bracha. That's like Rav Meir. And Rav Yehuda is saying, like Rav Yochanan, that even if you had a piece of inheritance in your house and you're buying something new similar to it, you would make a bracha. So, so we have no argument. Everything works good. When we turned around here and we said at the second line of the Gemara, we said Be'ika the Amre. We had another opinion. He says, now according to this, Ika the Amra, we have that the two are not going to match now. Let's see why. El Lishna Basra. So Bishlama, we could turn around now and say the Rav Huna is Rav Yehuda. Because if you look carefully, what does Rav Yehuda say? Rav Yehuda says that whether he has something from inheritance and whether he buys or if he didn't, either way he has to make a bracha. So that's going to be like Rav Yochanan. That's what Rav Yochanan said, whether he had something like this in the house that he received or whether or not he has to make a bracha. But Rav Yochanan now, so that's going to be, Rav Huna is going to be like Rav Yehuda. But Rav Yochanan, who turned around and said that even if he had one and he bought a new one, even if he bought a couch and he goes later and buys another couch, Rav Yochanan says that he still has to make a bracha. And we see that that's not what Rabbi Yehuda said. Rabbi Yehuda only said that if he inherited one piece from his house from the beforehand. So once again, El Rabbi Yochanan, the Amre, come on. Who's he going to be? Who's he going to hold like? He can't be like Rabbi Meir, because Rabbi Meir says that you don't make a bracha if you had something in your house, let alone if you bought it. V'loka Rabbi Yehuda, because Rabbi Yehuda said that the only time that you make a bracha is if you had something that you did not buy personally. And then you went and bought, Rabbi Yochanan says you make a bracha. Rabbi Yehuda says you make a bracha. But here Rabbi Yochanan is going to turn around and say that even if you bought one once and then he bought it again, you would still make a bracha. That's not like Rabbi Yehuda. So Amar Lecha Rabbi Yochanan. So Rabbi Yochanan is going to have to answer this contradiction. He said like this. The truth is, Huadin, the Rabbi Meir, Kana, the Chazar, the Kana, Nami Tzarech Levarach. Rabbi Yehuda is going to actually turn around and he's going to say that not only if you had a vessel as the same in your house already that and you bought a new one that you would have to make a bracha. But in fact, even if you personally bought a couch, a vessel, and you went out a little while later and you bought another couch, another vessel, exactly the same kind again, he said Rabbi Yehuda would agree that you have to make a bracha. Ay, v'had kamiflagei. So Rabbi Yochanan says, so you know what we're arguing about? B'yeshlo. But the whole idea here is to come and do something else. B'yeshlo, v'kona, that going back a step, that if you inherited a piece, you own it, but you never personally bought it. And v'kona, and you went ahead and bought now as the second time. So you had one in the house, and you went ahead now and bought a new one. Lo diacha koychad Rav Meir. This is really coming to tell you the power of Rav Meir. What's the chiddush here of Rav Meir? Da filu kona. According to the Lishna Kama, the Lishna Basra, according to the second opinion, he's coming to show you the power of the leniency of Rav Meir. Remember, this is a leniency. Because he's saying, not only would Rav Meir say that if he had one that he bought, and he bought one that he wouldn't, that but even if he bought and he had one in the house, you still wouldn't have to make a bracha. So it's not only that if you bought one and you bought another one that you don't make a bracha, but it's coming to show the leniency of Rav Meir that even if you had one, you received it in Yerusha, and now you're buying a new one, you would not have to make a bracha because it's not a new excitement in your life because you've already had it. That would be the chiddush of Rav Meir. And how much more so that if you bought one, and you went out and then bought another one, the Enzer Levarach. That would be obvious. That the whole question is would be not about Kona, the Chazar V'Kona, that would be an obvious to Rav Meir that you wouldn't have to make a bracha, but how much more so that even if you had it in your house, you still wouldn't. Okay, and that's how they solve the problem. So the Gemara just throws one more last curveball, and this is a really interesting little deduction from this. So he says, V'lif l'gu b'Kona, the Entzach Levara. So he says, why don't you, lo diacha koichod Rabbi Yehuda? Why don't we turn around and do the opposite? Why don't we turn around and say that really the chiddush here is not a chiddush about Rabbi Meir, that even in the extreme case, that if you personally bought one, and then you went and bought another one, that you do not have to make a bracha. Why don't we turn it around and say that the reason why there's a lishna basra, there's a second whole different opinion about the argument, is to tell us the strength of Rabbi Yehuda, that he's saying that not only would you make a bracha if you owned a couch and then you bought a couch, that you have to make a bracha, but that Rabbi Yehuda is saying that even if you go ahead and you bought one and then you went a year later and bought a new one, that you would have to say Shechianu. Let's show that one as the chiddush of Rabbi Yehuda's opinion. So the Gemara says here something really interesting. Koyach dehetera adifla. And that's how it ends. It says the Gemara, or the Torah for this matter, preferred, that was the word. The Torah preferred to show the power of leniency. And to me, that was something really very interesting, because as we know, always we come to so many different mitzvahs. We're always trying to machmir, and everyone is always trying to outdo the chumrah of someone else. I'm more machmir than you, and I do it more, and my thing goes further, and my go things. And here we see that these incredible Tanaim who were teaching us all the wonders and the wisdom of the most stringent way of doing a mitzvah, and yet it's not so. And yet when it came to doing anything, and even as simple as making just a bracha, not to make a bracha levatola, the Torah chose to show us the path of doing something in leniency. Woo. Okay. So now we're at the beginning of the wide lines. Mevarach al ara. So here the Mishnah says that when you make a bracha, about Baruch Dayan Emes, so it says, Baruch Dayan Emes, you say on something that seemingly in your mind was not good. And yet, if I'm not mistaken, I only had the in front of me. I believe it says something that was wrong that included some toiva in it, that it had something good. That was the statement from the Mishnah. So the Gemara is going to ask, Hey Chidami, in which situation do you have something that's bad that includes something good? So he says like this, the Shakal Badke Be'aret. He had the river, the water, a big stream of water come and flood his field, right? He just planted all the seeds, okay? And so he's trying to plant his field. Anyone who's in farming knows that while a field does need water, but on the other hand, if you go ahead and you overflood it, it's not good. And then you lose all the seeds that you just planted. So he says, but there is a benefit because first of all, you're getting a lot of water. That's number one. Number two, and we'll see in a second what extra benefit there was there. So he says, even though this is something good for him, what was the specific thing that's good for me in addition to simply having water? The maska ara sirtoin, because the water goes and flushes out all the stones, it runs them down the river, it takes up all different types of not fertilizer,
topsoil.
It cultivates the earth. So there's a element that's good in it, v'shvacha, and it appreciates the value of the land. Nonetheless, hashta miyasrai, but nonetheless it's bad because all the things that you just planted just went to waste. So he says, here's a situation where you would say, Baruch Dayan Emes, and nonetheless, it had something good that was included in it. Bala Taiva, here he says now the opposite. When you say a tova meitiv, something about good, that includes something that was not good. So the Gemara says, Echidam, in which situation do you have something that's good, which includes something that's not? He says, Kegon de Ashkach Metzia. In a situation, you're walking down the street, and you go ahead and you find, doesn't give me an example here, but you go ahead and find, Benny Gantz's cell phone. I don't know, okay? That's for those who are in the election. Baruch Hashem. Okay. You go ahead and you find something in Metzia, and there's no simonim, and you can't identify it back to anyone. No one wants to claim it. Benny Gantz was saying it wasn't mine because everything was revealed. So he says, Afal gav derai ledide. So even though, what was the bad part that could be? If you find something, what could be bad to you? because this was something so important. The reason why I was choosing this thing about the cell phone, you see, it says the ish shama be, because if the word gets out, shama be malka, if the king would hear that you found something that belonged to him, shaka lemine, he's going to go ahead and take it from you and punish you for keeping it. What?
IRS on the
table. Yeah, there you go. So even though you may think you found some money, you found the cell phone, you found something that could be valuable to you, but because if you're caught, you can get in trouble, right? Hashtag mia toivai, but nonetheless, now that you found it, it's something that's beneficial, whether it's the money, the cell phone, the golden dove, whatever the story might be, okay? It's still a good thing for you. You can make a bracha. Okay, so now here comes another, as they say, interesting piece of the Gemara. Haisa ishtamu beres. So if his wife was pregnant, ba'amar, and he said the following, remember we spoke about making brachas, but as some of the Mishnah was claiming that there's certain type of brachas you don't make. And you don't make wishful thinking as a bracha. You can have people, a person can have wishful thinking, but one should not have wishful thinking that's turned into a bracha. So a person should, you'll hear. So a person says, Yehi Ratzon, may it be Shetelet that she should give in this way. So the Mishnah over there says, Harezo Tfila Shav, that's a tefillah. If you made it into a bracha, I pray that my wife should have a son or something like that. That's Tfila Shav, that's a wasteful bracha, bracha levatol, and one shouldn't do that. So the Gemara asks, very good, Yossi. Below Mahani, what do you mean? Doesn't it help that if I daven for a son, right? Isn't that something that helps? Below Mahani Rahmana, won't Hashem help if I daven for something with a son or a daughter? So it goes like this. Meisiv Rav Yosef. So Rav Yosef asks, he brings an interesting hemshech from the story of Leah after she had her first sons, and now she gave birth to Dina. So he says, "Va'ach." The pasuk goes and says, "Va'achar yolda bas, v'tikra shma Dina." And after that, the Torah adds this word, "Va'achar." And after, she gave birth to a daughter, and she called her name Dina. My va'achar. Why does the Torah have to say? And after that, you could just say she had Reuven and Hashem Rabbeinu. Each time he had a son, she had a son, and she called the name. And now it's saying she had a daughter, and she named it Dina. Why does it have to say va'achar? Amarav la'achar shadana lea din be'atzma. It was only after that Dina made a personal internal calculation, and she literally Leah made a din about herself. Ve'amran, she said like this, and this is what I mean. We read this in the Rashi when we read the Shnai Mikru, we read Chumash Rashi. Yud bes shvatin, she had prophecy. Yud bes shvatin, there's going to be 12 tribes. Asidin latzes miyakov, that are intended to come out of Yaakov Avinu. Shisha yatsumi meni, I've already been blessed, and 6 have already come through me. But arba mina shvachos, and 4 already have come out, 2 from Bilah and 2 from Zilpah. Hare asara, and so now we already have 10 shvatim out in the world. Now this pregnancy that she has, says Leah to herself, im zeh zachar, if this now my seventh child is going to be a zachar, a boy, now what will be left will be only one child left to make it 12, and therefore my sister Rachel would be less in having children even than the maids that had 2 each, right? Zilpah and Bilhah. Because of that prayer and that deduction that she had on herself, that child that was inside of her turned into a daughter. Shenemar batikra shma Dina, because it says, and she called her Dina. So here we see that specifically in the Torah, someone davened and turned the fetus that was inside the baby from a boy, which seems to be that it was intended to be, and turned it into a girl. So what are you telling me that you shouldn't daven, and that's a tefillah shav? What's the Mishnah talking about? So the Gemara says, en maskri masa nisim. When it talks about making brachas, you can't get a reference from a miracle, from magic. Those kind of situations, although they do happen, but those are not references to something that happens on an average day to the average Joe like you and me. We don't reference a ma'is and nisim for a bracha or for any other halacha. V'ba'isema, we have another way of looking at it. Masa de Leah, this whole story with Leah, now we're trying to give somewhat of a scientific explanation why it worked over there and why it in general wouldn't work. Okay, maybe, yeah, Dr. Stein, we're going to have to find out if this is correct. That the whole story with Leah did not happen towards the end of the pregnancy when she started getting nervous about it, but rather it happened during the first 40 days of the conceiving of this baby. And so at that point, since at that point, the sex of the child was not known, they didn't know if it was going to be a boy or a girl because there was no image existing. So that's when a tefillah was able to turn it. However, in most cases, when people start to daven about these things, it's usually after the 40 days. And by that time, it was already destined what the child's going to be. And therefore, one cannot change it. To become formed. Correct. Okay. But here comes an interesting, this is how the Gemara learned this. Kedetanya, as we learned, Shlosha Yamim Rishonim, after the first 3 days of the mother conceiving, Yivakesh Adam Rachamim Shelo Yasriach, a man should daven that the seed should hold, that whatever started should hold and not get lost, because we know that not every time does it actually work, that it should hold. Mishloshav Ad Arbaim, from 3 days after relation until 40 days, Yivakesh Rachamim Shiya Zachar, that's the time when a person can daven that may the child that's developing become a boy. From 40 days and between 40 days and 30 and 3 months, Yivakesh Rachamim, he should have asked for mercy, that there should be not another pregnancy. There's something, I don't know if this is scientifically that. Yeah, no. Why? Because it's, I mean, Katuv Shama Mekevan Jay, he may have Pahamai. Right. Exactly. That is, okay. Yeah, we both. Yeah, we're basically saying that we're davening that when ultimately that there should be a child, that it should come out looking human. Yes. Basically, that's the thing. It shouldn't. Yeah, there was some. Yes, that's right. We learned about earlier. We're talking about. Right. Yeah. Mishloisha chadashim, from 3 months ad shisha and until 6 months, yivakesh rachamim shloya nefa. We're now davening that there shouldn't be a miscarriage, because usually that's the more common state of where a miscarriage can happen. So the person should daven, say that's the time there shouldn't be a miscarriage. Mishisha v'atisha, from 6 months till 9 months, yivakesh rachamim shietze b'shalom. Now we simply ask and we daven to Hashem that the baby should be born in peace. Mahani rach. What?
Yeah, please.
Go for it. It
used to be thought in science that at the time of fertilization, the chromosomes would determine whether it's a male or female. And this was the thought in science for many, many decades, up until about 10 or 15 years ago, I believe. I remember that they just discovered about 10, 15 years ago that the gender can change during the first 7 weeks. They said that's 42 days. It's exactly the same here. Wow. So this is like a new discovery that they just made.
They finally realized that tomorrow was right.
Jewish people know it about 3,000, 4,000 years.
Yeah. Woo!
Yeah. Give him another one.
Yeah, that's really good. That's a good one. Yeah.
Where did you read that?
Oh,
scientific journals. Keep Google it. You can find it.
Yeah, okay, I never found it.
Oh, wow. That's really cool.
I'm sorry. That's new to me.
That's what I'm telling you. It's brand new.
Well, there is new science out there.
Yeah, you know everything.
Okay, so the Gemara asks in the middle of the page, "Umi mehani rachmi? How can it be?" So here we had the statement. They brought this whole long statement to say that during the first 40 days, a person can daven that she become a son. And the Gemara says, "Umi mehani rachmi? Who says bechlal that such davening can help in the first place?" Baha Mar Yitzchak Barei Ravami. We had a statement by Rabbi Yitzchak, the son of Rabami. He says like this: "Ish mazriat chila yoledes nekeva." If during the relationship it's the man who comes through first, so then actually it's a female that is born, it's established. And if it's the opposite, Isha Mazras Tchilan, if it was the woman that came first, so then Yolad Zachar, then in fact the child that's born is going to be a male. So here we see that it's determined straight away from the relationship, not 40 days later. Shnei Amar, Isha Kisa Zriah, as we said in the Torah, the Parshas Tazriah, Isha kitazria, if a woman goes ahead and she comes for a biyolda zachar and she gives birth to a boy. Hach b'mayaskinan, what are we talking about over here? Yigon she'ezriyo isham.
Oh boy, after this year, after this year.
Okay, so.
I totally disagree with his interpretation.
After this year.
My interpretation, they said it.
It says a human fetus does not develop its external sexual organs until 7 weeks after fertilization. That's the development. It's got to develop whatever it is. It just doesn't show up to them because of the hormones.
So maybe it's not being recognized until 40 days.
That's what I'm saying. But it is what it is. That's how I
it's open. Is it okay? Good. Okay. B does it make? So how can it be? So first we're asking, how can it be that if a person davens, you can change it? When we have a clear pasuk from the Torah that is saying that if a woman comes first and it becomes a male. In other words, it's established right at the beginning. So the Gemara answers and said, "Kigon she'ezriu shnem bevasachas." That actually, when they both conceived, they both had their emission at the same time together, and therefore it was not a clear indication of which one it would be. That's when davening can actually help, and you can transform it or daven to make whichever one you hope it should be. Okay. Now the Gemara starts up with a completely whole new set of brachas and so on. Haya baba derech, if a person was coming on the way. And so now we're going to making up different types of brachas of help me, save me, whatever. When is it considered a bracha? When is it not? Tuna Rabbanon, our sages say the following. Ma'aseh b'Hillel HaZaken. There was a story about Hillel HaZaken, the first Hillel. Shaya baba derech, that he was coming from a journey. He was coming into town. B'shama kol tzvacha, and he heard a terrible shouting, ba'ir, in the city. And usually when you hear a big shouting, you know, when you come into the city and you start seeing all the cops on your road, you still, what's the first thing that comes to mind? Is it my house? I hope it's not my house. That's a prayer that a person says. If there's a hospital tragedy and you know that your house is right there where you've seen all the things, the first thing that comes to mind, you start saying, whether in a bracha or not, but in your mind, you're saying, I hope it's not my house, right? That's the thing. But he turned around and said, so basically we're saying that one should not go and make these kind of brachas, but here Hillel did exactly the opposite. He says, Muftachani, I am, it's promised to me, I'm sure, that the tragedy that's going on, even though everyone's yelling, it's not coming from my house. That's what he said. But Allah, and on people such as him, as Hillel, the pasuk says, Mishmua ra lo yira. He from a bad news that comes your way, that you would have to say, like Baruch Dayan Emes, you know, people start to, you know, cry, Chas V'Shalom, when there was a death, he says, if you hear a Shmua ra lo yira, he shouldn't fear. Nachon liboy, his heart should be truthful. How would you say nachon? Anyone have a good English there? Huh? His heart should be correct. Batuach b'Hashem, he should trust in Hashem. Because here, Hillel comes, even though you see something, and it could be not, he says, he would not be worried. Amar Rava. So he says like this. Kol heichei, let's see if I can remember all of these. The darshas lahai kra. In all places, when you read this particular pasuk, interesting, it says, Mereisha l'seifa midarish, miseifa l'reisha midarish. You can learn this pasuk from front to back and from back to front. So he says like this, Mereisha, you can learn this pasuk from the beginning, l'seifa from to the end, midarish, you can learn it. It goes like this, Mishmura, that if you had and you heard bad news, lo yira, he doesn't have to fear. And you put in, Matam, and what's the reason why a person should not have to fear? Because Nachon Liboy, because his heart is truthful, and Batuach B'Hashem, and because he's trusting Hashem. Now the Gemara says, Miseifel L'Reisha Midarish. You can actually learn this pasuk reading it backwards. He says, Nachon Liboy, Batuach B'Hashem. If you are a person who has a trustworthy heart, and Batuach, a truthful heart, and Batuach B'Hashem, and you are trusting Hashem, Mishmura Lo Yira. And that, as a result from there, you would not have to fear from any bad news. So whichever way you look at it, if you're a person in the right status of behavior and mind and heart, then bad news won't affect you. But again, that was a really, maybe that's where the trach good, but zan good, if you're in a good place, right? If your heart is calm and you are calm, everything is good. Ha'u talmida, there was that student. Dahava Ka'azil Basrait Rabbi Shmuel. There was a student who was walking behind Rabbi Shmuel. He was shadowing him, following Rabbi Shmuel, Rabbi Yossi. Bashuka de Tzion, in the market of Tzion. I'm not sure if there's a reference to Yerushalayim. But it says the Tzion market, like Machne Yehuda, this was called the Tzion market. Chazia, the Kamafti, Rabbi Shmuel, he turned around and he sees that the student was shaking. He was frightened. Amarle Chata Is. You must be a person who's done Averis. Dechsiv, Pachadu B'Tzion Chataim. Those who walk through Tzion are those who have done Averis, who have done sins. So the student says, what are you talking about? Amarle. So the student responds to Rabbi Shmuel, Aksiv, doesn't it say, Ashe Adam Mefachet Tamid? Isn't it a worthy thing that a person should always be scared? There's a puzzle that says you should always walk around scared. We're not going to mention people, but there are certain people that walk around always with their head and I get involved, and you know, they're always worried about something. All right? Amarle, Ahu B'divrei Torah. What could you be scared about? Be scared that you might forget the words of Torah. That you could be scared of. Oi, I learned something and oi, I might forget it. But to be scared of tzaras, that's not something that a yid should be scared of. Don't be scared of tzaras. Ahub divrei Torah ksiv, that's what he's referring to. Now he tells another story. Yehuda bar Nasan, havishakil va'azil, he was pacing and walking. Here, I don't know, I tried to find out why it said here, shakil va'azil, and over there it just says azil. Either way, shakil means he was pacing, va'azil, he was walking, bas right there, the Rav Hamnuna. And he was walking again behind Rav Hamnuna. Asnachle, and this Yehuda bar Nasan, when he was walking behind him, he went, gave a crutch, right? And it wasn't because of his kids. And so he said to him, so Rav Hamnuna said to him, Yisurim by Au Gavra, Lasuya Nafsha, when you go and you kvetch, and you start, what's the word? You go, ah. He says, when you do that, you're actually bringing on yourself Soros. Take it outside, guys. Doctor. So he says, when you go and moan, right? You think you're moaning about past or future worries. Here, Rav Nuna says, you actually are causing the tzaras to come to you. Moaning is not a good thing. He says, when you go and you start showing fear, all the worries that you were worrying about, you're actually bringing on yourself. Right? Don't go there moaning around. Be the simcha. Be happy. So again, this Rabbi Yehuda, Yehuda Bar Nasan says, "Vaksiv Asher Adam Efachet Tamid." Isn't it true that a person should always be fearful? And he answered him as well, "Ahu B'Divrei Taraksiv." It's also a reference that you can moan. The only time you're allowed to moan is if you're worried that you're going to forget Torah. So if you see a friend of yours moaning, you can say, "Oi, what a tzaddik! You're moaning because I see you're really concerned about losing your Torah, but surely." You're not worried about anything else in this world. Okay. Hanichnas lakrach. If a person now goes into the city, so he says like this. Baruch Hashem. Tan Rabbanan, our sages taught, b'chnisasai, when a person enters a big city, ma'u oimer, what does he say? Yiratzam l'fanecho, may it be the will of Hashem, Elokai, my God, shetachniseni lakrach, so that you should allow me to come into this big metropolitan, l'shalom in peace. Nichnas, once he entered the city, Aymer, he says, "My deni fanech Hashem Elokai, I thank you, Hashem, my Lord, my God, Shechnisani, that you lekrach zelishon, that actually I was able to enter without being trampled by all the cars and the buses and the trains. I was able to come in peace." Bikesh lotzes. Now he's preparing himself to leave the big metropolitan. Aymer, he says, "Yehiratzam lefanech Hashem Elokai, velokei avosai, may it be the will of Hashem." And the God of my father, that I should be able to leave this metropolitan in peace. Yotza, when he was able to leave the city, I thank my God, the Lord, that you're able to take me out of this metropolitan in peace. And he adds, and the same way that you're able to take me out of this metropolitan in peace, So you should lead me in peace, v'tismachayin l'shalom, and you should support me in peace, v'tatzideni l'shalom, you should continue help watching my steps in peace, v'tatzileni mikaf kol oyev v'oyrev, and you should help me and protect me from all those, all my enemies, v'oyrev, and those who are seeking to get me, baderech, on the way. So this is a bracha, these are all the different brachas that one can say, because in this situation, it's not a false belief, it was not a false bracha, but rather walk into a metropolitan with multitudes of people. You can get lost, you can get trampled, you can get robbed, and so on and so forth. And if everything went peacefully, you're allowed to make these brachas. Amar Rav Masna, so Rav Masna makes a condition of this. Lo shanu, this, you can make these all these brachas. Ela b'krach, here's very interesting. Only in a krach, she'en danin v'hargim boy. Only in a krach, in a place where there's no civil law, in a place that they don't take you to court and they just kill you outright. If they don't like you, they want to steal something, they go and kill you. That's when you can make these brachas. Aval bekrach, but if it's in a civilized city, shadonim, that let's say they caught you doing something, you know, it's not mass lynch, right? They thought you were stealing, and before you can go and convey your side of the story, they go ahead and they start whipping you. But in a case that if they thought that you did something wrong, they're going to go ahead and judge you. And only if you were found guilty, Bahargin, in that case, by Leis Leilanba, then you don't make a bracha, because then you weren't safe from anything. Because if Chas v'Shalom, you did something wrong, and etc., there is a civil way to deal with it. And therefore, by if you were saved, it was done in a proper way. There was no magic or miracle or davening that needed to take place. Amar of Masna. Ida Damre. No one was following here. Ida Damre, there's a different opinion. Ika Damar. Amar of Masna, he says on the contrary, Afilu Bikrach Shadonin, Bahargim Boy. He says that even in a krach that you do have courts, that if you were caught and you were sent to jail, and now they have to take a court case where you're innocent or guilty, in that case, even then you would have to make all these blessings, Tachnisen Shalom, take me out in Shalom. He says, why? Zimnin de lo misramele inch dialifle zechusa. He says, but sometimes you may not have a witness that will come and testify on your behalf. So it's nice that you have a court case, but they're going to say, do you have any proof that you're innocent? He says, well, no, I was by myself. And if you don't have any proof, you may be found guilty and even put out to death. So he says, because of that, going into a big metropolitan where you're not known and so on, it should be a situation that you're allowed to make this bracha. Tan Rabbanan. Our sage is told like this: Anichnas lebeis amirchas. When a person goes into the bathhouse, he says the following bracha: Yihiratzam lefanecha, may it be your will, Hashem Elokai, the Lord my God, shetatzileni mizeh, that you should save me and protect me in this bathhouse, el michayot seba, and from the like. Va'al yerabi devar kalkala, and no mistake should take place while I'm there. But not because of a sin. V'im yirabi devar kalkola, and if chas v'shalom some type of kilkul. How do you say kilkul in English? There's a word for it. No, Rabbi. So what's a kilkul?
Some kind of
destructive act. You know, whether you slip, or whether something one did something to you, va'avon, or because of an avera. And I died chas v'shalom. You can slip in a bathhouse. You know, te'mitasi kapara l'chol avonaisai. May chas v'shalom my death be a kapara for all my sins. You know. That's why when they have a slippery floor, they go and put out the big sign, be careful, wet floors, because people die from it, just from slipping. So that, you know, in the bathhouse, people are coming and going, it's all wet, and you don't notice. Amar Abaya, by asking this, lo lema inch hachi, a person actually should not make such a bracha going into a bathhouse. He says, why? Wow. The lo liftach puma l'satan, don't open up pelasan, don't open up an ayin hara. Nothing was going to happen, and by you turning around and saying, please protect me that I shouldn't die, you're actually opening up to the satan to give you an indication, the chas v'shalom. Yeah, you're giving him a little indication, an idea, and you don't want to give ideas to the other side. Da'amar, is this Reish Lakish? I'm not sure. Who's Reish Lamed there? Huh? Reish Lakish, okay.
How would you contrast that if someone's going into war? Let's say that's a different scenario.
Well, when you know for a fact that there is casualties, but people, 1,000 people go to the bathhouse, no one slips.
Right.
But the fact is, 1 in 1,000 will slip and chas v'shalom get damaged, get hurt. So we're saying don't, in a situation like that, don't, all is good. Don't make an indication of something you should. And he also, we also learned this, Mishmed Rabbi Yossi. We have a general rule in Yiddishkeit. Don't talk about a potential tragedy that could happen when there's no definite indication that it will. Don't give an opening to the other side, to the sitracha. Amar Rav Yosef. Rav Yosef says, Maikra, Dichsiv. Why do we, if that's the case, we have a pasuk that says, Kim ad kizdomainu, lamuradiminu. This was during one of the tragedies, or coming to it. He says, we almost became like Zdom in the destruction, and we've been compared to Amora. So here, it looks like it's a situation where the Torah is saying that you can mention a potential tragedy, and we don't say Al Titach Pelasatan. So my Hadarlu, so why does it say later, why does the Navi say, Shamu Dvar Hashem Ktsinei Zdom, and we see, that in fact, that was wrong to say it, because later the Navi turned around and said, you see, as a result of that, the captains of Zdom got all over you and they persecuted you. So by the fact that we said it, actually caused it to make it happen. King Nafik, when a person leaves the bathhouse, the Gemara concludes here, my Omer, what should he say? Amar Ravacha, Modin Ufanecha Shem Elokai, Sheitzultani Mina Or, that you saved me from. This was the bathhouse, apparently was not just the bathhouse, but a place, it was a sauna as well, that you saved me from such a place. Rabba Bao. What were that ish? I'm saying, so a place where you heated up the water, right? Rabba Bao Al Libi, Vini Afri. This was a funny one, I'm sorry. Does anyone remember what this one was? Give me the translation on that. He was in the bathhouse, I believe. And he slips. Right, that's what it was. The floor is open up because, and the thing is, okay, we don't even see it. We went to Mavoch Hama in Tveria, and we saw old Roman bathhouse. And they had literally these platforms with a floor with little beams all over it. And our tour guide told us that they had like these wooden plaques over them, and they would rush hot water under it so the steam would come through. So here it's saying that you're walking on these plaques of wood, but under it was this hollow, and it had boiling water. And if you chasm fell in there, it could be terrible. So the floor opens up from under him. Israchish le Niso, he had a miracle that happened to him. Kamala Mudi, he was able to hold on to one of those poles that was under the floor. Shasiv Mea Vechad Gavra, he was able to hold in his arm 101 people that would have also fallen into this boiling water, and he saved them with one arm. Wow. So the truth is, we can say him and Shimshon, who was greater.
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to stop there. Yeah.
It says over here that he held one or two people, and the other people grabbed onto that.
Right. He was all holding on to that one place. How's the time? We have 6 minutes. Should we go a little further?
Go further.
Okay. Amar Hainu, so he says, this is Hainu Drav Acha, Hainu Drav Acha. This is according to Rav Acha. The Amar Rav Acha, the Rav Acha said, Anichnas la kizdam, a person who goes in to
blood.
To what?
Let blood
out for health reasons. Omer like this. Yiratzon lefanech Hashem Elokai, may it be your will, Hashem my God. Shia Esek said that this action that I'm taking, it should be for me, li lerefua, it should be for healing. But tirpaini, and you should heal me. Ki kel reifen emanata, because you are a God who is truthful to heal. Who refuas cha emes, and your healing is truthful. Lefisha and darkan shel bnei adam lerapois, because it's not the way of man to be able to heal. It's only you, Hashem, who heals. Ela shenagu, but the reason why we go to doctors is because Hashem gave the power to a doctor to heal. So when we're sitting in the presence of a doctor, you should know that Hashem is right around the corner, right around them, because the power of a doctor is not of their own. It's not of their own. It's because Hashem is sitting there with them. So we were very privileged to have a doctor in our presence, right? And we all know that Hashem was together with us. So, Doc, thank you for bringing Hashem into our class today.
Don't forget the nurses.
Yeah, well, it's a team. But it's only because Hashem is giving the power. Amar Abaye. Lo lima inchiachi. He says you shouldn't make this bracha. The Tani that we've learned, the Bay Rabbi Shmuel and the learning house of Rabbi Shmuel. V'rapa yirapa. He said that we shouldn't even make a bracha about it. You go to the doctor, you have to make a bracha about it because it says v'rapa yirapa, that Hashem surely will heal me. Kanch nisna reshus l'roi filerapois. Because this was actually where we learned, and we've learned this in other places as well, that it was given permission for the doctor to heal. Because on one hand, I think what this pasuk was saying, that if Hashem decided you should be sick, how dare you go and change that? You're trying to change Hashem's indication. If Hashem wanted you to be sick, suffer. But that's what you, how dare the doctor should come and change Hashem's will? He says, because it was, this was one of those places where Hashem actually gives the doctor permission to change and heal this illness. So it's not just that he has the capability to heal, but he has permission to go ahead and heal. Kikai, my Oimer, when he comes out, as he say, Amar Bacham, Baruch Roifei Chinam. Thank you, Hashem, who healed us for free. You know, I didn't know I was going to get it, and I got it. Anichnas, turning the page, top of Samech Hamud Beis. Anichnas lebeis kakisa, person who goes into the bathroom. He says like this, Oimer, hiskabdu mechubadim. Let those honored guests be respected. Kedoshim mishar se'elion, those holy ones that serve the one above. Tnu kavod. I was just going to say that. Yeah, okay. Okay, who is he giving honor to? So he says, Tnu kavod elokei Yisrael, give honor to the God of Israel. Harpu mimeni, let me be. Ad shekanes v'etzer ratzoni, until I go and do what I need to do. So the Gemara here is saying that a Jew should know that there's always malachim following and protecting him and being there with him at all times. But when you come to a place of not, of, you know, personal activity and a place of something that's not clean, so we say to the angels, give me a moment. Let me do what I need to do, and then I'll be able to return back to you. Amar Abaye, lo lema in chachia. Abaye once again says, you don't go make those brachas. Dilma, shavkilei v'azlei. Because he says, what happens if you hang there too long and the angels decide to leave you, and when you come back out, they're not there? You know, sometimes you're not necessarily worthy of having chusim of malachim, but if the malachim are stuck to you, don't let it, you know, don't give them a reason to leave you. But the moment you go and tell them, hey, I'm taking a break, and they say, hey, you know what, this guy wasn't worth it anyway, and they may leave you. Lema shmaruni, shmaruni, azruni, azruni, smachuni, smachuni, amtinuli, amtinuli, ad shekanez veitze, sheken darkam shel bnei adam. He says, don't say anything, because you just do what you need to do, because they're malachim know that the ways of people is such, and therefore you don't have to go and make a special presentation about who you are and where you're going. Kinafik, and when he leaves, he says, Baruch Hashem Yatzars Adam B'chokhma. We know it's the special brach we all say. Hashem created you in wisdom. Uvarbo Nekavim, Nekavim, Chalolim, Chalolim, different openings and hollow spaces. Galu V'yadua, it's known, Lifnei Kisech Bodech, it's known in front of the glory seat of Hashem. Shimi Pasech Echadme, if that one open, Mehem, Oimi Satem Echadme, if one closed, Iyav Shalom Moda Fanech, we cannot stand in front of you. And my Chosim, and how do you end? He's, so one, Rav says, Raif Echolim, who heals the sick. Shmuel says, Kashavina, we've already learned in our house. Okay, I think we'll stop there. Everyone's running. Okay, we'll continue tomorrow. Yeah, this was done 1 in the morning trying to catch.